Good morning. We've been going through a series about our Christian life as a calling. That the everyday life of Christians is sacred and holy. We've talked about how we can change our lenses through prayer. How we can see the things that we used to think were mundane as something spiritual and beautiful through prayer. We've also looked at how our work, our careers, the things that we do in this world are spiritual. As we act as kind of a mask for God's providence, how when we pray to God, give us this day our daily bread, sometimes it's done through the hand of the farmer. We've also looked at how the little things we do just in our lives in general can give us, are indeed spiritual when we choose to be a blessing rather than a curse, that where we choose life every day in everything that we do, God works through us in the things that are little. And this morning we're finishing out our series, we're bringing it full circle, and talking about how our call as Christians is rooted in the church itself. Now, one of the things that we've talked about is the mistake of compartmentalization of our lives. And we do that for a lot of reasons. One, it makes it's easy to organize our lives and our headspace like that. I've got work life here. I've got church life here. Nary the two shall meet. But the fact is that's impossible, because our lives run into each other. And the second is it's not true, as we've seen. These areas overlap. One of the reasons we do that, though, is the same reason that you do it on a submarine or a ship. They compartmentalize so that when one area is damaged and not functioning, the whole thing doesn't fill with water. The whole thing doesn't sink. The problem is we're not ships. We're not submarines. What we are is Christians. And so what I want to do is I want to look at this morning a specific mistake that I think we make often. There was a guy who used to write love letters to his girlfriend every single day. He went to college and she didn't, and he was off and he decided, I'm going to write love letters to her every single day. And so one day he writes this love letter. He thought, he always writes them short, and he thought that this one would be pretty good. He said, "You are the center of the universe." Closed it, put it in an envelope, licked it, sent it off. And she would always write back, but it went a couple days and he didn't get anything. And after about 3 days, he gets something back, and it's the most, it's not what he expected at all. She's very angry with him. And she says, "You said that I was the center of the universe. Now I know my science, and the center of the universe is a supermassive black hole." Now, here's the thing. What she did was she made what's called a category mistake. What he was writing was a love letter. What she read it like she was reading a science textbook. What I think we've done as Christians is we've made a category mistake with three specific questions. Who are we? Where are we? Where are we? And what are we doing? The first one, and each of these are questions of identity. The first one, who are we? We make a mistake that the secular world makes. And we identify ourselves in a primary way. And usually, especially with men, it's our occupation. We say, if you ask, you know, tell me about who you are, one of the first things we start with, at least with men, is, well, I work at so-and-so. Or I, some of us define ourselves by our family roles. I'm a father. I'm a mother. Some of us define ourselves by our spousal role. I'm a wife or a husband. And these are good identities. Don't mishear me. These are good things to be. But what we've done is we've made a mistake in thinking that those roles are primary. That those roles are the things that tell us who we are. When the truth is much different. In 1 Peter chapter 2, if you want to turn over there real quick. There we go. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. You see, who you are, according to Scripture, the way that Peter set this up, he says, you are a priesthood. That's your primary identifier. That's your primary identity. Now, you might say, well, what does that do? In the ancient world, the primary function of a priest, you might have been taught that the primary function was to give sacrifice. Well, that's only partially true. The primary function of a priest in the ancient world is to represent the deity, to represent the God that they worship to the people and the people to God. And so when Peter calls us to be priests, what we are supposed to be, our primary function, is to be God's agents of God in the world. That's your identity. You may be a father, and that's a wonderful blessing and a wonderful responsibility. But as you're a father, the role that comes over that, the role that colors that, changes how you do that, is the role of being an agent for God. You may be a farmer. You may be a doctor. You may be a technician of some sort. You may be a mother. You may be a spouse. But all those identities are subject to the identity of a priest in God's people. You were once not a people, it says, but now you have received mercy. You have been called out of darkness into his marvelous light. Now, the thing with all those other identities is they're all temporary. You might not be a spouse forever. Your husband or wife may die before you do. You may not be a father forever. Children, unfortunately, die before their parents. You won't be working where you're working at forever. People retire. These identities that we latch onto to give us meaning, they pale in comparison to who we actually are. A chosen people. A royal priesthood. And so our identity in Christ, our identity as the church, is primary. The second of the second and third questions, I kind of combined them I was thinking about them. The question of where are you and what are you doing? There's a story that I heard a great Bible teacher tell. It's told of a Jewish rabbi about the time that Jesus lived. He was walking around and he was reciting Isaiah chapter 43, as the Jews were wont to do. They would recite scripture to themselves, and he was reciting and saying, "You will be my witnesses. You will be my witnesses. You will be my witnesses." And he gets stopped. He's not paying attention. He's reciting things over and over again. He gets stopped by this Roman soldier at a garrison saying, because he's wandered where he's not supposed to be. He says, "Who are you?" What are you doing here? The rabbi stopped and thought a moment. And he said, how much does Caesar pay you to ask me that? He says, I make 12 drachma a week. He said, I will pay you double if you'll stand outside my house and ask me that every morning. Who are you? And what are you doing here? First place I want to go is in 1 Corinthians to answer these questions. We read earlier a passage from 1 Corinthians 6, and that passage that we read is rooted in this idea of body. Starting in verse 12, it says this. For just as the body is one and has many members, and all the members of the body, though many, are one body, so it is with Christ. For in one spirit were we all called and baptized into one body, Jews or Greeks, slave or free, and we were all made to drink of one spirit. For the body does not consist of one member, but of many. If the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, that would not make it any less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell? But as it is, God arranged the members in the body, each one of them as he chose. If all were a single member, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, yet one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again, the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, the parts of the body that seem weaker are indispensable. And those parts of the body that we think are less honorable, we bestow the greater honor. And our unpresentable parts are treated with greater modesty. Which our more presentable parts do not require. But God has so composed the body, giving greater honor to the part that lacked it, that there may be no division in the body, but that the members may have their same care for one another. If one member suffers, they all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Now you are the body of Christ and individually members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, helping, administration, and various kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all possess gifts of healing? Do all speak with tongues? Do all interpret? But earnestly desire the higher gifts, and I will show you a more excellent way. And so, here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul unpacks this idea of the body of Christ, the church. And what he says is, you individually are members of the body of Christ. That means that your actions affect the whole body. And he does not just mean the local congregation here. He certainly does mean the local congregation. But what he's talking about is the church universal. That you, what you do, affects God's work in the world through his church. Now, if that doesn't sound like a heavy responsibility, you need to hear that again. What you do affects God's work through his church in the world. What you choose not to do affects God's work through his church in the world. When we read 1 Corinthians 6, he says, do you not know that you are members of Christ's body? Therefore, when you unite yourself to a prostitute, you unite Christ with her. That image of sexual ethics there, it kind of gets at this idea that when you act with the body. And so when we're thinking about our identity as priests, what we're doing in the world, and where we're doing it, I want you to think about how is what I'm doing serving the body? Because that should be our primary question as we walk through life. Not the millions of other things that we worry about. But the primary focus is, how is what I'm doing serving the church? Not just the local congregation, while that is important, but the church as God's agents in the world. Now you might say, well, I'm not like you, Brian. I'm not going to get up and preach. If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? Each of us are equipped in different ways, unique ways, to further God's cause in the world. The question is, are we going to embrace that responsibility or reject it? We have been called, each one of us. Now you might say, well, but I'm not very good at anything. I can barely keep myself together and my family together. How can I be a force for good? Well, I'll tell you this. Keeping your family together and keeping yourself together is part of that. It is part of this. What I don't want you to mishear me is, I don't want you to hear that you need to reject all your goals that you have and focus on the goals of the church. That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is, your goals need to be couched within the goals of the church. And so, if you're looking for a promotion, great. Pursue it. Do it. That's a wonderful pursuit. But if your reason for looking for that promotion, if your reason for furthering your education is not thought through, and thought through to the conclusion that if I do this, I can help the church in these ways, you need to start thinking like that. Because if you don't, you're not really thinking about where you are and what you're doing. I think one of the biggest problems that we have as Christians in our relationship with the church is that we think that we leave church. There's a good old a cappella song that I like that says, you can't go to church, as some people say. They say it's common terminology we use every day. You can go to a building, that's something you can do, but you can't go to church because the church is you. And what I think that song is kind of silly in getting at is the idea that we think, and we fall prey to this, we really do, that there is a time where we are not at church, or we are not the church, and that is just simply false. And that's what Paul's really trying to get, and that's why we read that scripture at the very beginning. He says, if you go to see a prostitute, you take the church with you. We don't leave church. Our lives, there's not a space in our lives that is not church life. When you give to charity, you give as part of the church. When you yell at your spouse, you're doing that as an agent of God. The question is, are we going to be faithful with that? In John 13, Jesus charges his disciples. John 15, he charges his disciples. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you
unless you abide in me. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So the where are you question, I want to ask, are you abiding in the vine? Are you understanding your life through this lens of, I belong to Christ. I am part of his body, and my work is his work. Or are you just doing your work? Because we do that. Secondly, I want to look at John 13, 35. It says, by this, people will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. What kind of witness are you giving? What are you doing? Are you abiding in the vine? And are you loving one another? And if areas in your life aren't serving those goals, aren't putting you in those places, you need to maybe rethink those areas of your life. We began our series with a discussion of the Lord's Prayer and how we can use prayer as a rhythm in our life, as a cadence for living, to give us a set of lenses through which to view the world. How we can understand, as we hear the words again and again, that we should be about God's mission in the world, forgiving others as He forgives us. That changes how we live. What I love about the first statement of the Lord's Prayer, the first bit, kind of, I think, encapsulates all this that we've been talking about. He says, the very first bit, he says, Our Father. To say those words, what you're doing, if you want to say them truthfully, is you're claiming to be a child of God. You're claiming to be rooted in the church, to be part of this priesthood. And then the closing words of that prayer. Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Is an example of this priority shift that I'm asking us to take. And it's a priority shift that's a pretty substantial change. I made a joke at the beginning of this discussion about the love letter, how she's made a category mistake and it's funny, it's ridiculous. But the thing is, we make just as a ridiculous a mistake if we try and identify as something other than the body of Christ. And that mistake is not silly. It detaches us from each other. It detaches us. It gives real space between us and the church. When people say, man, you know what? I don't feel like going to church. I know they've made this mistake. Because you don't not go to church. What you do is you live the church. And when we come together like this, this assembly is not the church. Our lives, as we work with one another, as we engage in the ministry of God through our work, through our homes, through our families, that's the church. This is where we talk about it. This is where we sing about it. This is where we meet Christ at the table to be changed by His Spirit. So this morning, maybe you've got your priorities out of order. Maybe you failed to realize the ministry that you're in. You failed to realize where you are, what you're doing, and who you are. If you've never made that realization and you're ready to make it now and confess it and put Christ on in baptism, this is the time for that. Maybe you made that confession a long time ago, but the deceitfulness of this world has pulled you into the trap of identifying as something else. If you need to recommit this morning to who you are, to where you are, and to what you should be doing, this is the time for that as well. If you have any need, would you come as we stand and as we sing?